Hi everyone, welcome back to AIC. For those of you that follow me on the socials, you know that I got to attend my first International Association of Black Actuaries annual meeting this year in New Orleans, and I decided to share with you guys some of the highlights, memorable moments, and I guess just a sneak peek of some of the things that we got up to. We stayed at the Roosevelt Hotel in New Orleans, which is basically the hotel that the conference was being held at. My travel was fully sponsored by my organization, as they are also one of the corporate partners of the IABA. And at night, we got to go to the famous Bourbon Street, where all kinds of talented and gifted people go there for all kinds of performances and food and drinks and just having fun. The following morning, we had professional development sessions, and I attended one on diversity, equity, and inclusion in pricing and underwriting. I saw a minibar in this hotel room, and I was ready to eat and drink all this food and all these drinks. Well, some of these drinks, I don't know some of them. And apparently, you pay to even drink a juice or soft drink or water. Can you imagine being charged for water? Normally, I thought that when you come into a hotel room and you see all of this, it's like free. But nope, it's not free, and they're gonna charge you $75 for a wine or whatever, and $8 for gummy bears. $8 for this gummy bears. I'm just shook. This is how hotels get us. I went back to the meeting area for a lunch and learn. It was such a good experience to kind of just engage more with people, eat some good food. We had fried chicken and some veggies. I got to sit with some of my friends and kind of catch up on the day.
Sorry, I can't be there with you guys at the IABA meeting. Sounds like you have a very exciting program, and being in New Orleans isn't too bad either. excuse me. I'd like to thank you for giving me an opportunity to participate with you on this panel. I'd like to start with the first question for your panelists as to how would they describe the actual value proposition? What does an actuary bring to the table?
And talk to them about problems. They want to be able to see more, yes, the value proposition, more the solution, and in the solution, be able to articulate it a little more better in their own language. And we have, in the actuarial profession to go a little more beyond just seeing risk and coming with the red card everywhere, but leading a little more in value, solution, and
lend itself to having a bunch of conversations with other people and seeing where is the place I can make the most value. So I know that there's a lot of folks here that's early in their careers, in their profession, so I'll just make this last comment about the journey. Interviews are a two-way street. It's not just about you looking for a job to get a paycheck. It's about the company or organization that can best support you and you can thrive in so that you can give the most value. So every time I do an interview, as they're taking notes, I'm taking notes too. And at the end of that interview discussion around, I should be able to say, well, I know how I can come to this organization and create value for this organization. And I tend to,
I like to take risks in my personal life, but professionally and academically, I've always been intrigued by how we make decisions with uncertainty. So I was an economics major and I loved game theory and figuring out how to make decisions with different actors, with different incentives.
Lead with purpose and passion, always. And we've seen it in 2020 with people just quitting, you know, a lot of their jobs, with, you know, people looking for deep meaning into what, you know, they're doing every day. That is important. And I also want to highlight that it's very, very critical, especially in our community, in the you know, Black community or marginalized group, to also make sure that we are valued, that we receive the true value of what we do, that we are paid, you know, for our true value, even as we're looking to make sure that what we do has a meaning for us, what we do is connected to our own mission here on Earth.
Be able to not just make an impact in insurance, but also in other industries. I think as people come along paths of getting to know actuaries is what led itself to actuaries, you know, like working outside of insurance. And I think, you know, in combination with organizations such as the IABA, CAS, and other organizations, of course, we do need that more like, as a community, we all need to get together to be able to push some of these boundaries. But I think on an individual level, an opportunity to just explain what you do in a way that just doesn't really translate to insurance context, but just more overall a risk context, I think is going to help to shift that. So I would love to get it to the point where in the future, you know, most people know what an actuary does. It's as common as being a doctor or a lawyer. And that when you look at how people make decisions, it's accounting for some of the actuarial concepts. So I think that's a future that I'd love to see.
The Launch and Learn session was very insightful. We got to hear from brilliant minds, also had a Q&A towards the end of the session and got to engage with the panelists just to hear what they think about the profession, where we are headed to, and sort of how to bring value into what we do every day. The next event of the day was a networking session, and all the companies had booths and students will come to talk and interact with professionals and sort of just, I guess, communicate what they are seeking for in terms of internship or full-time, share their resumes, and some of them even landed full-time offers, internship offers, or just opportunities to learn more about different companies that offer good opportunities for us.
Signal crew. This is the other side, it looks so different. Where did you go? I was like, I think was this for the parade, maybe?
Yeah, let's see the parade.
The last event of the day, we went to the Orpheum just opposite the hotel, and it was a very casual networking session, and there was a bar, good music, good food, just interacting with different people in a very informal setting.
Down there looks like a wedding.
Another dinner because the food was not that good for me, so gonna get dinner at a restaurant. And here we go. I need to tie my laces. The last day, I also attended another professional development session. This one was on data visualization by Deloitte. Friend and I went to get corporate headshots and just got ready for our next professional development session. I think this session was my favorite. It was about diversity, equity, and inclusion in employee benefit products or packages. And we kind of talked about how, for example, as an international worker, you face a different dynamic such as sending money home. And that on its own may require you to have like a different kind of employee benefit package that may not be necessarily used by an American, for example. And so just making these products accessible and how we as actuaries play a big role in ensuring that these products are available but also usable to marginalized groups.
So I think that the employee benefits with a D&I lens can kind of round out some of the differentials of how you got here versus where you want your employees to go.
And really focus on that benefits piece. And so, you know, we've spent some time really showing that there are bones, right? The data shows that there are discrepancies and differences based on race and gender and income. But what can some employers do? So we start thinking about it. We know there is a problem, right? Like we saw in the data, there is a problem. What do you think employers can do to help address some of those issues? So we're looking for people to give some strategy, but it also things like Actuarial funds and different things. And so employers are trying to balance their fiduciary responsibility, right? Like, can you have funds that don't pay interest, right? Versus the needs of people. But when we lead workshops with people, especially from different diverse groups, some of like they would not be able to participate in their 401k because none of the asset classes are part to be used because of their religion. And how do we address certain things and certain needs like that for employees? So it becomes a lot, right? It's a lot of...
After the networking session, we went to get brunch with another friend who was also coincidentally visiting town around the same time the conference was. So we went for brunch and we walked because the place was only 8 minutes walk away.
From college for brunch, so come with me.
No.
This is Faye. This is more fun than you.
This is I'm Faye. Dead. Yeah.
Nobody has to see goodbye to her. She just like sucked out everything.
I also my grill, so.
There you go. It's giving content. Yeah. But I think this summer has been just so great for me because I also met like make a bunch of content creation.
This is the courtyard of the restaurant. Yay. Faye baby. Giving content. It's giving content. Content creation.
You're
gonna get ready before 5 because it's at 5.
After brunch, we went to the gala / our dinner.
And if you're a member of this committee, please join us on stage. The winner of the committee of the year this year is the technology committee.
But the second person, this award should be called Goes Above and Beyond Mentor of the Year. He has been actively involved in IABA from the day he signed up to be a member. He is the mentor for several students and those young in their career, in this room and outside. He provides advice on their career, what to do about their exams, their college courses, and life overall. He devotes his time and his talent without hesitation, and I am honored to call him my colleague and my friend, Lauren Danielson.
Thank you. So the Lifetime Achievement Award, this is something that is very important to the organization. It does represent a set of years of achievement, milestones accomplished for the organization, and it goes to individuals that...
If Kate's house was on fire, what one thing would Kate grab before leaving?
Just thinking,
yeah. One thing.
One thing. Okay.
If Kate's house was on fire, what one thing would Kate grab before leaving? I'll begin with you, Jeff. What do you think the one thing that she would grab?
Her organizer?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm assuming her kids are
there. Right. And then she crossed the kids out because she's going to leave them. But okay, the organizer, right? All right. Francis? Her what? Her phone, okay, all right. Brandon?
I said laptop.
Her laptop, okay. And Nicole?
Ditto.
What?
Laptop.
You say laptop on your phone? Okay. Oh, turn it around.
My laptop.
Her laptop, give it up!
Love it. I almost had my kids too. And I was like, they can go.
They've got feet, they can go. All right.
Thank you.
the ceremony, there was an open dance floor and it was so fun. I unfortunately couldn't leave the sound on because of copyright issues, but I am so glad that I got to attend this conference because it was honestly everything and more than what I could ever imagine. I was very, very impressed by the organization, the people there, the way they just made everything fun. It was totally beautiful. Thank you guys for watching, and I'll see you next time.